Can I move on? obviously there are divisions and arguments within.
But
the,
taking you up on that. But I mean, supposing your loved ones say, "But actually, I mean, I know you're in great distress, but actually, we want to care. We want to care for you, and we think that actually your life still has value. It may only be another month or so, but actually, that month will be a very precious month, both to you and to me."
There's something a little bit odd, isn't there, about a religious person who believes that there is life after death and an atheist who doesn't should be taking these positions. I mean, in some ways, it might go the other way around.
I agree. It could go the other way around, yes.
Can I move on to, I don't know whether schism is the right term, but there are clearly deep arguments within the Anglican Church, and you're famously, and I think laudably, on the Anglican, on the liberal wing of the Anglican Church. Is there a sense in which there's a... Again, I suppose it comes back to the point of maybe the other side are the ones who are being true to the fundamentals of the religion, and you, who are liberal and much closer to what I would think, are the one who's departing from the... certainly from the scriptural perhaps from the fundamentals.
Well, if you take the issue of homosexuality, there's no doubt about it. There are a number of texts, not as many as people think, but a few texts, which clearly regard homosexuality as wrong, both in the Old Testament very strongly, but they're also there in the New Testament. But, of course, it's a question of how you interpret the Bible, whether it's really right to just simply extract a few isolated texts, rather than seeing the whole message of the Bible, the whole message of Jesus. But I think there's another, perhaps even more fundamental one, which links in to your fundamental interest in evolution. Our understanding of what it is to be a gay or lesbian now is very, very different from what it was, let us say, in the Roman world when the New Testament's written. I mean, they really thought that people could really choose either to have homosexual relationships, heterosexual relationships, or be bisexual, as a lot of them chose. I mean, they thought it was purely a matter of choice. We now actually know that a significant percentage of people are predominantly attracted to members of their own sex. They didn't choose to be that way. The cause is still mysterious. We don't know whether genetic, biochemical, or psychological, or what. But that's how they find themselves. Now, it seems to me that we actually have to face that fact in exactly the same way we have to face the fact that the world evolved over 4.5 billion years of this Earth. This is one of the facts you have to face. And I would want to say that there are certain fundamental principles in the Bible about marriage, about relationships, about loyalty, about faithfulness, which are quite properly transferable from heterosexual relationships to homosexual relationships. Now, so it's a question of the changing facts as well as a changing understanding of how the Bible should be interpreted.
This, of course, is all music to my ears, but I'm kind of left wondering why you stick with Christianity at all, therefore. And maybe some of the fundamentalists might say just that to you.
Well, I'm not quite so isolated
as you might think. I
like to think there are a good number of Christians.
Yes,
I think that perhaps it may be you spend too long in fundamentalist circles.
Yes. Yeah.
But the reason I stick with Christianity is the fundamental truth and beauty of the Christian faith, as it has come across to me, that there is a wise and loving power ultimately behind this universe, that this power has been radiantly accessible in a human life in Jesus, that there is a Spirit of God within every human being with which we can be in touch to help guide us and strengthen this life. All this, first of all, I find enormously attractive. And secondly, it has taken hold of me in such a way that actually I believe it to true. And that taking hold is not just a purely rational thing, though it is rational, I believe, but it is also obviously emotional and spiritual. Cardinal Newman once says, the whole person moves, paper logic is but the record of it. And I think that's probably true. The whole of me has been attracted and drawn into the Christian faith. It's partly rational, partly emotional, partly spiritual, partly moral.
I mean, to detach it from you personally, and I certainly didn't mean to suggest that you're on your own, I know you're not. I once went to a seminar in Oxford given by a Roman Catholic nun, And she stood up and said all the sort of right-on liberal things that I would wish her to say, and which you would wish her to say. And she got rapturous applause from the students, as you can imagine. But I was sort of feeling, well, the only reason she's getting this applause is that she's a nun who's saying these wonderfully liberal, sensible things. And you couldn't help feeling, I mean, I think I maybe actually asked her, well, why do you stay being a nun? If you think this, why don't you just throw over the Roman Catholic Church and, well, join the Anglican Church, for example?
Well, I think that the progressive and the more reactionary elements within the church have always jostled with one another. I mean, I think of John Ball, the priest who led the peasants' revolt with the wonderful phrase, you know, when Adam delved and Eve span,
who was then the gentleman.
So the radical elements and the more conservative have always jostled with one another. The church has a good record on some issues. I mean, I think its role in helping to abolish slavery and certain social reform of the 19th century, and it has an obstructive record in other areas. I mean, I think I have to face the fact as a believer that the church, because it is an institution and therefore seeks to persist through space and time, will, on a number of issues, whether I like it or not, be slow moving. Because the point about an institution is that it seeks to gather the insights of past ages and transmit them. And it is inevitably, therefore, fairly slow moving. And I mean, the alternative is to have a Christianity without an institution. But of course, then it would die out within a generation. Mm-hmm. If it's to persist through space and time, it needs to take institutional form. And therefore, although I may not like it, it's bound to be rather slow in taking on board some of the insights. I would hope also it would be driven by something of the radicalism of Jesus himself, who clearly wasn't an institutional man and set before people the ideal of the kingdom of God, wanted people to live it out here and now. I hope that, you know, that is still abroad within, even within the institutional church.
I hope so too. I once actually wrote an article called Atheists for Jesus, and I actually had a somebody gave me a T-shirt with Atheists for Jesus.
Well, do you know, there are two members of that society now. The other one is John Mortimer. He's also, I think, I should put you two together.
Yes, you would. One of the things that the church does, of course, is get involved in education, traditionally has. And in many cases, it's, of course, a very good education. I worry, however, about tying of labels around the necks of children who are too young to know what their religious views are. And this shows itself especially in places like Northern Ireland, where a child is branded a Catholic child or a Protestant child long before it knows what its views are, and then suffers, and I really mean suffers in the case of Northern Ireland, from that. I have a kind of immediate recoiling against the very phrase Catholic child, Protestant child, Muslim child. Do you have any of that, or are you quite happy?
No, I do share your worries. I mean, think particularly about Northern Ireland, and there's no doubt about it, religious education can in certain circumstances be divisive for the reasons you mention and other reasons. I think on the positive side, I genuinely do believe, I wouldn't obviously necessarily think this, that you would share this, that for a child to be brought up in an environment which is based on the assumption and suffused with the feeling that there is an ultimate meaning and purpose to human life, that our sense of human worth and dignity is ultimately grounded in something beyond itself, I think that this gives a dimension and a kind of richness to an early child's education that it is difficult to think of as a purely secular education giving. So I cannot help feeling that however the strong the values might be in a purely secular school, and I have no doubt about it that they can be very strong indeed, nevertheless there is a kind of deprivation there of what I would call this other dimension, a sense of the of richness, which I think a religious early upbringing can give.